Chairman of the Select Committee, Harriett Baldwin.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker, and I know it hasn't been long since we had an autumn statement, but I still think that we heard today that the Leader of the Opposition has no plan. It's not been very long since we had the last forecast from the Office for Budget Responsibility, so I thought it was interesting to read today that in the just over 100 days since they made their last forecast, there have been a lot of changes for the better in the UK economy. In particular, I'd like to highlight that they are expecting better inflation outturn than they were just over 3 months ago. They're expecting and have noted the sharper fall in interest rates that we all pay on the national mortgage. And they have also said that they're expecting living standards for the British people to recover more quickly than they were previously forecasting. And I think this is information that we can all welcome today, Madam Deputy Speaker. Now, I know there will be a range of views across this chamber about the role of the Office for Budget Responsibility. And of course, we all know that forecasts are all likely to be wrong. We will be scrutinising the Office for Budget Responsibility next Tuesday morning in the Treasury Select Committee, and we look forward to asking them the questions about their assumptions. But my view in terms of their role is a bit like the Sir Winston Churchill quote about democracy, that it's the worst form of government except for all the others that have been tried. So I think that although all economic forecasts are likely to be wrong in some way, and the Office for Budget Responsibility forecasts certainly often will not be the most accurate, I think it's a lot better than the alternative of either the Treasury marking its own homework, or indeed better than having a budget with no forecast from the Office for Budget Responsibility at all, because I think it reassures the markets on which we are so dependent for our borrowing. Now, there's obviously been good and even better progress on inflation since the peak of over 11% after Putin's evil invasion of Ukraine. And it's vital that all of today's budget measures are looked at through the lens of the inflation, because we don't want to have anything that could prevent that progress towards 2% that the Bank of England is expecting by the middle of this year. And I think that we heard today from the Chancellor that he has looked through exactly that lens when he has announced the measures today. So there are a range of things that will really help. The 5 pence off the price of fuel at the pump going on for another year will be very helpful to drivers in West Worcestershire and elsewhere in the country. The freeze on alcohol duty will be welcomed in the pubs across West Worcestershire and across the country. And the public sector productivity plan, I think, is crucial to make sure that we get value for money from our public services. Now, when it comes to the second economic objective of growth, I think we can all welcome the fact that employment growth has been so strong that the economy has created over 800 jobs a day over the last 14 years. And at previous fiscal events, we've seen steps in the plan that help grow the productive size of the UK economy, because now that we're at full employment, that becomes incredibly important, because it helps sustain non-inflationary growth. So to take one example, Madam Deputy Speaker, in terms of stimulating that all-important investment into the economy, the big announcement a year ago was the full expensing of investment, and indeed that was made permanent at the autumn statement. Today we heard it's going to be extended to leased assets as well. And what the BBC in their fact check has noticed, that when this was first announced, it was expected that the economy would benefit greatly. The Chancellor said its impact on the economy will be huge. And the Office for Budget Responsibility said it would increase business investment by 3% a year. Well, in fact, since the policy came into force on the 1st of April, We've seen the level of business investment for the whole of the year last year was 6.1% higher than it was in 2022. So we heard today some more welcome steps that will increase business investment and other investment into the UK economy. Whether it was the tax reliefs in some of the creative industries, whether it was the announcement for British ISAs, which should encourage more investment and long-term investment into our economy, the back-to-work plan, the childcare plan, there were lots of other measures that will unlock growth.
Would you give away?
I will give away.
For giving way, but I just wonder if she thinks that the Chancellor, indeed herself, is being a little bit complacent over the issue of investment, because although it's true that business investment is higher now than it was in 2010, it's still the lowest in the G7 and amongst the lowest in the OECD. So why haven't we seen more public investment from the Chancellor today? Because we know that public investment will crowd in that private investment. Why haven't we seen much bolder, more ambitious work on investment today, which is what this economy is crying out for?
Today from the Chancellor about how strong the growth in UK investment has been. We've heard additional investment in terms of the productivity of our National Health Service. And we also heard, and I think this is absolutely crucially important, measures that will increase the attractiveness in investment in some of the fastest growing sectors across this economy. And I give way to my friend.
I'm grateful to my honourable member. Does she agree with me that it's extraordinary that the honourable member for the representative of the Green Party didn't welcome the £270 million for advanced manufacturing in clean aviation, in clean vehicles, the £120 million in clean tech manufacturing. This is the UK investing in the technology of clean growth, is it not?
Well, it is indeed, and I'm glad that my honourable friend welcomes it, even if it was not welcomed by the representative of the Green Party. I think that what we can see in terms of, if I just make a little, do you want to talk on investment? On investment?
I want to just take her back to what she just said about the investment in childcare and remind her, of course, that this week brings International Women's Day and that cost of childcare is such an important issue for so many mums in this country. And of course it was the Conservatives who rolled out the 30 hours of free childcare. It's the Conservatives who are rolling out free childcare to 2-year-olds and 9-month-olds. And we absolutely must welcome that additional investment for childcare and indeed in families through the support and child benefit that will help mums to get into well-paid jobs.
I wholeheartedly endorse what my honourable friend has said, and she is absolutely right to point to the importance of this investment in childcare in helping female employment growth. And female employment growth has already been remarkably strong over the last 14 years, and I'm confident that these measures will make further progress in increasing the non-inflationary growth capacity of the UK economy. I think there were other measures that announced today that will help on the growth front. I think cutting national insurance again is also a smart way to help growth. It not only adds money into working people's pockets, of 27 million people across this country will see an extra £900 a year in terms of money in their bank accounts, but it will also make work more attractive. And we've heard from the Office for Budget Responsibility that actually it's cutting national insurance that has the biggest marginal impact in bringing people back into work. 94,000 from the last cut. It'll be interesting to see whether they continue to expect that to have a significant impact. It's a really smart way to cut taxes for working people. And another point that I'd like to make about it is that it's UK-wide, so that it will be felt in Scotland as well. In terms of debt falling, Madam Deputy Speaker, we can see that the bond markets have stabilised. The Office for Budget Responsibility numbers confirm that progress in terms of debt. I want to just bring the House's attention to a report that we just recently published in our committee that focuses on the Bank of England and its quantitative tightening. They themselves are selling £100 billion of gilts into the market over the course of this year. They've acknowledged that this actually increases the cost to the Exchequer of borrowing by probably about a tenth to a quarter of a percentage point. And so I think as a cross-party committee, we wanted to flag up the impact that that could potentially have and send a message to the Bank of England, the independent Bank of England, about some of the ways in which quantitative tightening does have an impact on the real economy. And as a cross-party committee, we obviously are never going to agree on the level or scope of taxes between us, but one of the things that we do have unanimity, and does he want to come on the fact that the rate of tax is higher in Scotland?
What I do want to raise is the issue of quantitative easing that she's just highlighted, because there's obviously going to be a very significant supply of gilts over the course of the coming period, and that obviously is going to have an impact on the gilt market, on yields that are there, and of course it will influence the Bank of England and what happens in the interest rate cycle. And crucially, out of all of that, it's going to make it pretty difficult in the coming period to see any material growth in money supply, particularly M4. That is going to impact growth, given where we are.
Well, I'm sorry he didn't acknowledge that income tax is higher in Scotland, but he does make a very good point about quantitative tightening and its impact on the real economy, and it is potentially out there as a factor that can have a real impact, and we will be watching it very closely on our committee. We're, as a cross-party committee, never going to agree on the level and scope of taxes, but we do agree that the tax system is too complicated. We have a very complicated tax system in this country with well over 1,000 different tax reliefs. But I do think that despite the abolition of the Office for Tax Simplification, there have been some major tax simplifications under this Chancellor. We've heard about the way in which he eliminated in the autumn statement the national insurance class. We've heard about how he has simplified the lifetime allowance for pensions. And we also have heard today that he has started to tackle some of the very perverse cliff edges, high marginal tax rates and disincentives to work that do exist throughout the tax system. By raising the VAT tax threshold, he has helped small businesses who may hold back because they don't want to go through that. And in terms of universal credit, we've done so much over the years to reduce those high marginal tax rates and disincentives. And so it was great to hear the Chancellor today really focus on addressing this high income child benefit charge. Yeah. When we brought it in, and I voted for it at the time, £50,000 a year was a high rate of income. With the progress in terms of higher incomes, the median income in those days was about £22,000, now the median income is about £35,000. And so £50,000 these days is not more than about 40% over the median income. And that's why it was absolutely right today that the Chancellor recognised that in his budget statement. And he has made the taper that much less of a disincentive to people taking on work above that income level. Of course, I'd have loved to have seen him do even more, but I am very grateful for what he has done. Did someone try and intervene on me? Was that? No, I was just hallucinating there. Right, I will come to a rapid close then. Madam Deputy Speaker, what I want to say is that it is clear that on this side of the House, there is a plan. Yeah. It is clear that there is a plan to get inflation down. It is clear there's a plan for increasing the growth rate and the growth capacity of the UK economy without sparking inflation again. And it's clear that there is a plan to get debt falling. And I think we can all see that that plan is working. I think we should stick to that plan and not go back to square one. Yeah. Before